I'm Richard Newell. I'm the President of Resources for the Future, and I want to welcome you to this important workshop we're having today. Thank you for taking the time to be with us here, both in person and online. For those of you who are not familiar with us, RFF is a nonprofit research institution located in Washington, D.C. Our mission is to improve environmental, energy, and natural resource decisions through impartial economic research and policy engagement. Since 1952, RFF has been committed to being the most widely trusted source of research insights and policy solutions leading to a healthy environment and a thriving economy. For two decades, RFF has been at the forefront of scholarship to identify economically efficient ways to mitigate greenhouse gas emissions. Most attention has been given to legislative approaches that would put a price on emissions, either through a cap and trade system or a carbon emissions fee or carbon tax. And that work continues at RFF under an initiative called our Carbon Pricing Initiatives. The demise of the Waxman-Markey proposal for a national economy-wide cap and trade system in 2010 created a vacuum that was filled by the Clean Air Act. In 2007, the Supreme Court affirmed EPA's authority to regulate greenhouse gas emissions under the Clean Air Act. Subsequent to a formal endangerment finding and absent legislative action, the Clean Air Act, the EPA is compelled to act under the Clean Air Act to mitigate harm. RFF research was among the first to look at how EPA might regulate greenhouse gas emissions under the Clean Air Act. In a series of papers from RFF beginning back in 2010, my colleagues looked at approaches to regulate greenhouse gas emissions using different parts of the Clean Air Act. EPA moved forward with the Department of Transportation first to regulate fuel economy and tailpipe emissions along with the Department of Transportation. But the greater policy challenge was regulation and how to address stationary sources, in particular existing power plants, which along with transportation is one of the two leading sources of greenhouse gas emissions nationally. In 2015, the EPA announced the final version of the Clean Power Plan and attempted to infuse the regulation with compliance flexibility and also gave states latitude in how to achieve the requirements imposed on their states. However, subsequently in the winter of 2016, the Supreme Court stayed the Clean Power Plan, and that set the stage for the EPA's proposed repeal of the Clean Power Plan in the current administration and its expected replacement. Because of the economic significance of the Clean Power Plan, often referred to as the CPP, the agency is required to submit a regulatory impact analysis, or RIA, to assess the costs and benefits of the action and also the actions to repeal the Clean Power Plan. The RIA that accompanied the Clean Power Plan in 2015 saw significant net benefits, that is, benefits of the action greater than its costs. Perhaps paradoxically, the RIA for the repeal of the Clean Power Plan also sees significant net benefits in its repeal. This raises a question of how the same agency can come to very different conclusions when seemingly looking at the same thing. And we're going to explore this a bit today. In general, the assumed benefits from the original 2015 RIA fall into two roughly equal-sized parts. One part has to do with the benefits of reducing greenhouse gas emissions, specifically carbon dioxide emissions. That aspect has received a lot of attention and was driven by adjustments the administration made to calculating the so-called social cost of carbon, which is the economic value in dollars of reducing one ton of CO2 or carbon dioxide released to the atmosphere. Those adjustments related specifically to the choice of the discount rate used for the calculation of the social cost of carbon for valuing future damages, as well as to the treatment of damage to U.S. citizens of impacts and actions that take place outside of U.S. borders, the so-called domestic versus global carbon social cost of carbon issue. RFF researchers have been very active on this topic, and the Energy and Climate Program at RFF recently launched an initiative on the social cost of carbon to improve the way this estimate is calculated following recommendations of a recent National Academy of Sciences report on the issue. But that's not the focus of today's event, and so if you'd like more information on that, please check our website, or you can talk to me after the event to get more information. Our presenters will instead spend the bulk of their time today talking about what has changed in the other major category of benefits according to the 2015 regulatory impact analysis. That is the calculation of conventional air quality benefits of the CPP. Changes in the way the agency calculates the benefits of reducing air pollution will have important implications not only for regulating greenhouse gases under the Clean Air Act, but also for a wide set of other regulations. The repeal of the Clean Power Plan in that sense is a leading indicator in this regard, and so we look at it to see how and what implications there are for other regulations as well. To help us do that, we have three outstanding speakers today. The first is Alan Krupnik, a senior fellow at Resources for the Future. He's going to talk to us about the choices EPA faces in its conceptual approach to estimating the benefits of reducing conventional air pollutants, which tend to also fall along with greenhouse gas emissions if greenhouse gas emissions are being directly targeted. So there's these co-benefits. Kathy Fallon Lambert, our second speaker, is director of the Science Policy Exchange and the Science and Policy Program at the Harvard Forest of Harvard University. She's the author of several studies that have looked at the effects on air quality, health, and ecological effects of air pollution, as well as the direct impacts of climate change. And our third speaker, Dallas Bertraw, is the Dryas Gaskin Senior Fellow at RFF, and he'll address and summarize and discuss alternatives that the EPA faces going forward. One logistical note for those of you watching online, you can follow us and tweet questions to the panel when we go to our discussion using hashtag AskRFF, that's A-S-K-R-F-F, and we'll also try to get to those during the discussion period. With that, let me welcome our first presenter, Alan Krupnik, who's had a busy day. He just got back from testifying with the House Energy Subcommittee on North American Energy Integration.
Thank you, Alan. It's a busy day. Well, it's a pleasure to make it here on time. The representatives do go on. Sorry, any watching. Okay, so I'm going to, we at RFF have a project ongoing here on looking at the costs and benefits of repealing regulations, both thinking about some of the conceptual issues and also thinking about actually re-estimating the regulatory impact analyses in the context of eliminating or modifying regulations following indications to do that by the Trump administration. So look to this space for future events on that. But what we're talking about now is the CPP and the RIA to repeal it. So I want to do three things. I want to talk about repealing rules nomenclature, ancillary benefits in RIAs, and then thresholds in concentration, mortality, response functions, kind of wonky, but very important, and the regulatory impact analysis. Richard started down this path, but I'm going to try to make it a little directly address it. So the cost of a rule, when you're that's the cost of a new rule. When you're repealing the rule, that becomes the cost savings. So costs go to cost savings of repeal. And then the benefits become foregone benefits. So it's the benefits we're not going to get. So in a way, these two are just switching around. And then the net benefits of a rule, so a new rule, would be the benefits minus the cost. So that's real straightforward. But then when you get to the net benefits of repeal, it's the cost savings minus the foregone benefits. So I probably thoroughly confused you now, but anyway, that's the terminology that we've kind of settled on. Okay, so now for ancillary benefits, these are the benefits that come, as Richard mentioned, that come along with CO2 reductions that were the main focus of the Clean Power Plan. So in the RIA for the repeal, we find the following sentence. The Obama administration relied heavily on reductions in other pollutants emitted by power plants, essentially hiding the true net cost of the CPP by claiming benefits from reducing pollutants that had nothing to do with the rule's stated purpose. So how sensible is this statement? Yes, you're right. It's not so sensible. So first of all, nothing's getting hidden here. For those that would take the time to look at the regulatory impact analyses, it's quite clear there are separate tables and separate discussions about the effects of reducing fine particulates on health effects and that these reductions, so if you substitute coal for coal, if you substitute natural gas or renewables or nuclear, you're going to get reductions in nitrogen dioxide emissions and particularly sulfur dioxide emissions. And these are both precursors in the atmosphere to creating fine particles, what we call PM2.5. So these come along part and parcel with any attempt to reduce CO2 emissions because it involves these substitutions to other fuels. So that's clearly in that whole discussion is in there. There's nothing being hidden. And these benefits, these ancillary benefits, are benefits of the rule. So they should be included. And this statement is just not true and not helpful. But there is one sort of issue. And I think the agency, EPA, is very careful about this. But it is an issue that you have to watch out for. And that is double counting of these benefits. So if we're reducing PM2.5 as a result of and the precursor NOx and SO2 emissions as a result of the CPP, when the next rule comes along, you can't forget about that because that's already supposed to happen. So the new baseline against which you judge reductions in NOx and SO2 has to include this reduction here, and so on all the way back in time and forward in time. And that's not easy all the time to do. But I think the agency is quite aware of this and they do a good job with it. Okay, I'm going to spend the rest of the time talking about thresholds in this relationship between PM2.5 concentrations in the atmosphere and the effect that has on mortality. This is what drives the ancillary benefits in the CPP and really every other air pollution regulation that the federal government issues. It's a very powerful, strong relationship. So EPA did, in the RIA for repeal, did three analyses, actually. The first one was the original analysis with the signs more or less reversed. So the way EPA typically does these analyses is to assume there are no thresholds, because that's what the science basically says. There's no evidence that no strong evidence that PM2.5's effect on mortality has a threshold below which there's no impact. So they go all the way back to the origin. That results in big benefits of the Clean Power Plan, the original rule, and so there are big benefits foregone if you get rid of it. And so this means, with the cost being cost savings equal to the cost pretty much, then this means that there's going to be big negative net benefits of repeal. So it's a bad idea to repeal. And that actually is what I would consider in the body of the RIA, the main analysis, although that kind of gets forgotten about in the press releases. But that's the main analysis. Then there's two sensitivity cases. The first one is a threshold at the NAAQS standard, the National Ambient Air Quality Standard, at 12 micrograms per cubic meter. So this is basically saying there's no effects on health of reducing PM2.5 below that standard. I'm going to have a picture of this in a minute. So what that led to is ignoring a lot of benefits that were in the original analysis. So that leads to very small foregone benefits of repeal. And that leads to positive net benefits of repeal. So that's where you get the headline about repealing CPP is good. They also did a second sensitivity analysis, which is interesting. It's a threshold at the lowest observed concentration level seen in the two studies that underlie these concentration response functions used to estimate the mortality impacts. So that's kind of a middle estimate, and in that, using that one, the negative net benefits, they're actually negative net benefits of repeal. So both that one and the original argue against repeal. All right. Now, setting standards at assuming there's a threshold at a standard is actually not a silly thing for those who don't know anything about the actual process. Because the Clean Air Act is very clear about this. It says standards are to be set to protect public health with a margin of safety. So the plain English meaning of that is there's a threshold. Find it and set the NACs a bit tighter. So that's what this diagram shows. So this is the mortality rate in the vertical axis, PM2.5 concentrations on the horizontal axis. And here's what an example of what the people who wrote the Clean Air Act kind of envisioned, that there'd be this linear function, and let me see if I can do this. Yeah, there'd be a linear function here, and then below that, there's a threshold where there's no effects down here. And then what you would do is you would set the standard there, so there'd be a little bit of a margin of safety. So that's the idea. Okay, what's the reality? The reality is there's thresholds. There are no identified thresholds in this vast literature linking PM2.5 to mortality. It is the largest literature of any pollutant health effect, bar none. The experts in the Clean Air Scientific Advisory Committee, which advises EPA on setting these standards, wrestle with this evidence. And they try to do various things. They try to find like a knee in the curve of the concentration response function. I'll show you what that means. Or a point where what's called the marginal observed health effects are smaller in number or less severe. So what that means, instead of this kind of relationship, this is the one that EPA uses. So it's a nonlinear relationship, and you can see here that a small change in concentrations does very little to affect the mortality rate, but a small change in concentration here does a lot. So the effects are not constant across, depending on where the concentration you start with is. And then a knee of the curve analysis, which is not something they actually literally do, but it's kind of the thinking, is, you know, you might set it here where these marginal effects on health really start increasing. So you'll want to get rid of this by setting a standard tighter. Okay. So then the second sensitivity analysis is this lowest observable concentration, using that as a threshold. Because, and it turns out, so you're estimating these dose, these concentration response functions, and these are sort of the data points that are in your study that look at this rate to try to estimate this linkage. And so you do your regression analysis, and you find, you fit this curve to it, and you find it has this shape. But it turns out, of course, it might turn out, it does in these two cases that I talked about, is that there are no dots below the lowest observable concentration by construction. So basically what you're saying is we have no idea, we don't have any data for what the slope of this function looks like over in here. So that's the dilemma. Now, there are different ways of handling it. So the way the RIA handles it is to assume that those go to zero. So there's a threshold right here. It's not the only assumption one could make. One could make that it's horizontal. One could just continue the curve down to the origin the way EPA does it. So what do we conclude from all of this? The first is that ancillary benefits are legitimate. There's no reason, no justification for not including them in the analysis. Second, assuming a threshold at the standard for PM2.5 mortality is not legitimate. The evidence does not support that. It's not a legitimate practice. However, acknowledging uncertainty below the lowest observable concentration, I think is a legitimate thing to do, and to maybe deal with it as one case of a threshold. But if you're going to start doing that and trying to look at how various uncertainties play into the estimate of foregone benefits, you ought to acknowledge that there are uncertainties that would make these benefits foregone larger. So don't just look at the things that'll minimize the benefits. Look at some things that would make them larger. After all, that statistical model I showed you before with the dots, that has error bands around it. So you could get the actual true relationship between PM2.5 and mortality may be quite larger than the one that EPA uses. So you got to be even-handed about it. And I don't think the administration was even-handed. So one suggestion I have, and this is the end, is find the threshold to equate foregone benefits and cost savings from repeal. Find that. So equate the two and work backwards to see where the threshold would need to be to equate these two. And then ask if that threshold is reasonable given the evidence. So I would have liked to see EPA do something like that, and that would be enlightening. So that's all I have to say. Thank you. So we'll take questions, I guess, as a group afterwards. Okay. Do you know what? You want me to get this for you?
Thank you, Alan, and thanks everyone for coming today. I'm going to pick up where Alan just left off and talk specifically about those ancillary benefits. First, I want to acknowledge my collaborators, without whom this project definitely would not have been possible. So I'm representing this group, which has a vast range of expertise, and we brought this group together because we really view the issue of co-benefits as a matter of understanding the full benefits of a regulatory standard or rule. So in order to understand the full benefits, we have to take into account some of these changes that Alan was talking about, the kinds of reductions that come from co-pollutants and the benefits to health and ecosystems from those reductions. So a team like this enabled us to look at a full suite of endpoints, the health effects, the effects on ecosystems, specifically trees and crops from reductions in ozone, effects on visibility in things like class one wilderness areas, and effects on acidic deposition. So some of these things respond quite quickly to changes in emissions and pollutant concentrations, and some respond very slowly over time, particularly ecosystems. And so things like lags in the times of implementing changes can have a significant effect on the benefits that are realized as systems become more sensitive over time. We also, in looking for an understanding of the full benefits, want to also consider the full range of exposure. And an important reason for doing that is that this map shows expected PM2.5 concentrations in the year 2020 under the reference case with the implementation of all the standards that are currently on the books. And as you can see, across wide areas of the country, of the lower 48 states, we expect PM2.5 concentrations to be below the 12 micrograms per cubic meter, which is the current NACs. So in order to understand what's at stake for large populations of the US, we have to include an understanding of what the effects are below the NACs. So this team has worked over a series of several years to institute this power plant carbon standards co-benefit study. And again, when we talk about co-benefits, we're really talking about understanding the full benefits. We looked at a series of three policy cases, an inside the fence line case, which I'll tell you about in more detail, a beyond the fence line case, which very much resembles the Clean Power Plan, and the third scenario, which I won't talk about today, is a social cost of carbon case, which basically takes institutes any emissions reductions that would cost $43 per metric ton or less. And we compared the emissions and pollution concentrations to a reference case, as Alan said, that accounts for all the existing standards and the reductions that those would achieve. So to date, we've published this series of three papers. And as far as we know, it's the only study that is spatially explicit, covers the full 48 states, and includes both an inside the fence line and beyond the fence line option compared to a reference case. So if you're following this issue, you probably know that this has new relevance these days as we think about the repeal and what it might be, what the Clean Power Plan might be replaced with, which some might say is probably something that looks like an inside the fence line approach. To do this work, we used a multi-model platform. So we started with outputs from the integrated planning model, which is an equilibrium power sector model that solves for the least cost means of achieving electricity generation given the decision rules of the scenario. That is run for all 2,400 power plants in the country, and the emissions outputs from those model units are used in CMAQ. So CMAQ is a air quality model, very similar to what the EPA uses, and it produces gridded air quality outputs at a 12 by 12 kilometer grid for the entire US. We use the 2007-2020 platform, so it holds meteorology constant at 2007, and it uses a 2020 base case. The parsed unit level output from that CMAQ model for air quality is then used, we then use that in BenMap. So BenMap, for those of you familiar with, is a conventional model that overlays baseline population, incidence, air quality concentrations, and compares that to a change in air quality with a concentration response function to estimate mortality and morbidity effects in the future. And we also, in order to understand full benefits, use that same CMAQ output to look at changes in acidification using a model called PNET-BGC, ozone benefits for trees and crops using the W126 ozone metric, that if those of you who know about the ozone RIA was used in that analysis, and also visibility effects. So today I'm going to do a deeper dive into those two scenarios that are particularly relevant. Now, the beyond the fence line, like the Clean Power Plan, and the inside the fence line. So and we're going to focus on the health effects. So to set you up for that, the beyond the fence line is a state-specific rate-based performance standard for power plants. It establishes a benchmark emissions rate for each state, and it achieves in 2020 an emissions rate target of 1,500 pounds for coal and 1,000 pounds for gas plants. It allows a flexible approach to compliance, so this sounds familiar if you know the Clean Power Plan with averaging and trading across the fleet and across state lines. And state can also develop alternative plans using a mass-based approach, provided that it allows it generates equivalent reductions. So the inside the fence line case that we used here is by no means the only approach that could be taken by an inside the fence line standard, but this one uses takes the needs database, establishes a best-in-class heat rate for 15 different categories of coal plants, and then sets a standard whereby the plants must close the gap between their current heat rate and 40% to close the gap to the best-in-class. So it can do that through unit retrofits and also by a modest amount of co-firing with natural gas or biomass. And this scenario improves the fleet-wide average heat rate by 4%. It achieves a national average emission rate of 2,000 pounds per megawatt hour for coal and 1,000 pounds for gas. And there are no new coal plants built under this particular standard. So let's take a look nationally at the types of emissions reductions that are achieved under these two different scenarios compared to the final Clean Power Plan. So the beyond the fence line, and our model year again was 2020, achieved a 35% reduction from 2005 levels in CO2, 27% SO2, 22% NOx, compared to the inside the fence line standard that we analyzed, which achieved a 17% reduction in CO2 from 2005, increased SO2 emissions by emissions rebound by 3% nationally, and had a slight decrease in national NOx emissions. So if we compare that to the final RIA, the 2015 RIA for the Clean Power Plan, as well as the more recent repeal, we see that the final Clean Power Plan achieved a 32% reduction in CO2 emissions by 2030, with SO2 emissions reductions either 21% in the initial RIA or 31% in the most recent repeal RIA. And for NOx, the emissions reductions are 21% or 23%. So you can see that our beyond the fence line scenario was pretty close to the final Clean Power Plan, particularly when we take into account the fact that the actual emissions reductions will depend on what the actual state implementation plans look like. So I'm going to show you a series of maps now that take the output from both the CMAQ model and the BENMAQ model and compare them for those two different scenarios. So the bottom line for the air quality results is that for the beyond the fence line option, all 48 states see some improvement in either PM2.5 concentrations or peak summer ozone compared to the 2020 reference case. The states with the largest average decreases are shown here. And because of these improvements, 41 million people in 41 large cities would gain higher air quality. Compared to the inside the fence line approach, where there are large areas of eastern and western US that experience a decrease in air quality in 2020 compared to the reference case. So I'm going to show you these maps. The first set of maps is for the beyond the fence line option, followed by inside the fence line. These are projections for the year 2020. In this case, the darker brown, the color, the larger the reductions in air pollution. So this shows you expected PM2.5 concentrations for the US under the beyond the fence line. And you can see that there's up to a 1.25 microgram per cubic meter decrease, with, as you'd expect, the greatest increases in the Ohio River Valley and also around coal plants in the West. This is the same analysis for the inside the fence line approach. And in this case, the darker the blue, the larger the increase in PM2.5 concentrations. And in this case, we have concentrations up to a half of a microgram per cubic meter. For peak summer ozone, these are the changes, again, the darker brown being the reductions in air quality for ozone in the beyond the fence line case. And here for the inside the fence line, a modest increase in peak summer ozone, particularly in the Pacific Northwest. So now let's take a look at the resulting health benefits of the two options. So you see here, I've summarized, our paper has this split out by pollutant, but I've summarized here total premature deaths avoided for the two options, total hospitalizations avoided for either respiratory or cardiovascular effects, and total heart attacks avoided. And these are for adults, ages 18 to 65, depending on the metric. And to the far right there, the beyond the fence line, we estimate a central estimate of 3,500 premature deaths avoided for the beyond the fence line option, compared to an inside the fence line option where we would expect to see a central estimate of 11 new premature deaths total nationally. Now, that national number hides some of the state-based details because, for example, the state of California has 33 premature deaths under this scenario, but there are offsetting premature deaths avoided in other parts of the country. And you can see the results for the other metrics here as well. So as Alan mentioned, the concentration response function turns out to be a really important driver of the estimates of these benefits. And so I just want to point it out for those of you who are devotees of this topic, we took what might be a slightly different approach to the most important Health effect, which is responsible for most of the cost, which is the mortality associated with PM 2.5 reductions. And instead of using the two-point approach, the American Cancer Society study and the Six Cities study, we used the Roman et al. Expert elicitation to develop a central estimate and a standard error. So we used 1.0 as our central estimate, and 0.4, we assume that it's a log linear function, not a nonlinear function, and we looked at effects down to zero. The other concentration response functions that we used, we focused specifically on large cohort studies that were multi-city studies over long periods of time and across a range of exposures. So there's the Roman et al. And I want to point out, there's in case on the same topic, and this will be the only other slide I have on this, is that there is a, to Alan's point about the shape of the curve and the importance of understanding that response, there is a new study that was published this summer in the New England Journal of Medicine that really took on some of the questions around what's the appropriate concentration response function by using the complete Medicare data set for the whole Medicaid population, Medicaid, from 2000 to 2012, and it includes 60 million people across the entire U.S., so that's across the wide range of exposures, not just what you would expect to see in some cities where you would have higher exposures. So it looked across that whole range of exposures down to the lower concentrations and had 460 million years of follow-up. So this is a really important study for answering some of these questions. And what it found, just to highlight in their own words, was that there is the all-cause mortality associated with these pollutants is an almost linear relationship with no signal, again, no signal of a threshold, down to that lowest exposed concentration for both PM 2.5 and ozone. They also looked specifically at the concentration response at that lower level of exposure. And so when they restricted the analysis to below the NACs, they actually found that there was a steeper slope below the NACs, meaning that for every unit decrease, you have a larger health benefit than at the higher ends. And then last, they showed, so exactly what I just said, is that higher benefit is larger below the annual NACs. So this is a very important study for addressing some of these questions about what the concentration response should be for that highest value benefit. There's some other really important information in the study, including the fact that they looked at subgroups, and black men have a 3 times higher mortality risk than do whites. So now let's look at how these health benefits from our study play out across the country. So here are changes in state number of premature deaths avoided by state in the year 2020 for a beyond the fence line approach. Couple things to notice about this map, it's all purple. So that means in every state, there is at least one premature death avoided under a standard that looks like the Clean Power Plan. Another thing to notice is that the darker purple have larger benefits, and those are typically areas where we see the highest populations in areas that have the lowest antecedent air quality. And so I put on the side there some of the specific state numbers for the states that have the greatest benefits or the greatest foregone benefits if we're talking about a repeal. Here are the maps for the inside the fence line. The red showing you states where there is a increase in premature deaths above the reference case. And I show you 4 states there where you have the deepest red. In California, of course, you have nearly very little coal influence there. So any change, co-firing with biomass or increased efficiency of nearby coal plants will have a relatively large effect in California. Then we can look at it again Looking at a percent change in risk. So what's the percent change in the risk if you take out population? So if you live in Maine, for example, just because there's not a lot of people there, doesn't mean that you don't care about the risk to you and how that changes. So this map looks at the change in risk, irrespective of population. And here you see that for the inside the fence line approach. And again, the pattern of the increase in risk here, the areas in red, very much reflects the pattern of where you see increased PM2.5s in the CMAQ projections. We then, in our PLOS One paper, we estimated the costs and benefits. So you can see those summarized here. We estimated the health benefits to be $29 billion per year. The benefits from the social cost of carbon at 21. So we are slightly more than half of the benefits in this analysis go to the health benefits, and an estimated cost of $17 billion, giving a net benefit of $33. So you can see down here how that compares to the 2015 and 2017. And again, there's this puzzling flip, and not just the magnitude, but the sign of the net benefit, depending on which approach is taken in the final RIA of the appeal. And it is rather puzzling that you could have a flip in not just the amount, but the sign, the direction of the benefits from a strong positive to a negative. Here we see how the value of the benefits map across the country, again, looking very much like the risk map. And then this plot, because I'm running short on time, I'll go quick, but this basically plots all the different analyses that have been done and the benefits they provide per ton of CO2 reduced. So you can see that all of the analyses about the Clean Power Plan pretty much cluster together with some separation in terms of SO2 averted, NOx averted, and then premature deaths, there's a bit more of a scatter. But what I would like to call your attention to this now is that purple triangle or pink triangle. So that's the inside the fence line approach. And if we're moving into a conversation about a beyond the fence line or an inside the fence line approach to carbon standards, that's the difference that should really stand out to you here. So I have two sets of takeaways. One is from the study that I just described, and a couple of things which I'm sure you noticed. So carbon standards can produce large and widespread improvements in air quality and health outcomes that far exceed the costs. But the design of the standard matters greatly and influences the magnitude and the distribution of those benefits, with an inside the fence line standard potentially generating disbenefits or harms. So the results demonstrates the importance of comparing the full costs and benefits for a range of policy alternatives and reference cases. Just queuing this up to show you that we have a new study we're working on now. So keep your eye out for this that looks at different types of rollbacks. And then because the topic of this seminar was implications for future policy, I put together a few takeaways on that point as well. So from my perspective, having worked on air quality management issues for going on 20 years, starting at Hubbard Brook, where acid rain was first documented in North America, we're trained to think about these things as multi-pollutant problems. And so I think this research shows that a multi-pollutant approach is important for illuminating emissions interactions, unintended disbenefits, and for identifying policy approaches that have the largest benefits per ton to the public. Scientific understanding of both the many endpoints and their benefits and the impacts of these various levels of exposure is increasing. At the same time, we see an RIA that may go the direction of decreasing these benefits and how they're included. So underestimating the benefits in a cost-benefit analysis could lead to a less rational policy decision that's vulnerable to overturn and creates a regulatory uncertainty. Some would say that states are picking up the slack. I think that may be true. We're seeing some evidence of that. and so that might mitigate these foregone benefits. But for cross-boundary pollutant issues like this, a patchwork approach certainly is unlikely to achieve the same level of benefits that you would see in a national standard. And then last, just to end, I think part of what this points to is the need to perhaps again codify acceptable practices for cost-benefit analysis with guidelines for addressing full costs and full benefits. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So now it's my turn to follow Kathy's tour de force. I want to start by mentioning that, as Richard said at the outset, scholars here at RFF have been involved in this area, looking at the Clean Power Plan for seven, almost 8 years now. And I want to acknowledge that my insights are, what's going on here? Page down, that one, okay. I'm indebted to all my colleagues here who and other research assistants who've done fantastic work, and we've generated nearly a dozen publications related to the topics that we've been talking about today. So now, this is outlined for my talk, but before going on, and to give you a little orientation to sort of where we've come so far, there are three major changes in the repeal RIA, distinct from the original Clean Power Plan RIA, that are generating the change in values for net benefits. One of them has to do with the treatment of the social cost of carbon, and Richard gave us a brief introduction to that, and it's a subject of a whole separate body of research at RFF. So just, I think people have some good background on that. Second has to do with this calculation of co-benefits, which Alan and Kathy have been talking about. And then third has to do with the treatment of energy efficiency in the RIA. And the energy efficiency in the RIA, there is no change in the ultimate valuation the way there has been, as Kathy described and Alan described, with respect to co-benefits. But what's happened is it's an accounting transaction, if you will. The Obama period RIA looked at net benefits, so that the reduction in resource costs for associated with compliance and counted them as a benefit on the benefit side of the ledger. The repeal RIA says, well, if there was no energy efficiency, there would be certain resource costs for compliance. And then with energy efficiency, there's going to be program costs and participant costs. And they add together those two types of costs to come up with a grand total on costs. The conundrum there is that some of the resource costs are not going to actually be incurred because you're going to be incurring these energy efficiency costs. But that's the grand number is big, and the reason that's significant in the current policy context is that it leads to a repeal suggesting that there's bigger cost savings, because there's cost savings with two overlapping, almost double counting sources of costs that are being averted. But in the context of the 2-for-1 regulation, RFF has had previous seminars on that, then you get more bang for the buck from the repeal of the Clean Power Plan. So those are the three general categories. And now what I want to do is talk about the status of repeal and replace, how much could be achieved in terms of emission reductions under a likely replacement regulation, and possible approaches and conundrums that face the agency. So remember the timeline. In 2007, the Supreme Court affirmed the authority of the agency, and the 2009 endangerment finding implied that the agency was compelled to mitigate the harm. And EPA chose Section 111 from among other choices that it had for regulation of stationary sources under the Clean Power Plan. And then in February 2016, the Supreme Court stayed the final regulation for the Clean Power Plan for Section 111D, which regulated existing sources, existing power plants. Then in October 2017, just recently, EPA announced repeal of 111D. And the legal handle for that is, among several arguments that are made, is challenging the Obama's period interpretation of the best system of emission reduction. So the statute calls for a standard of performance that is interpreted based on the definition of the best system of emission reductions. And the Obama EPA chose to interpret the electricity sector as a system. and that it was a system that delivered energy services to your home or your business, and the changes in one part at one power plant would certainly affect the operation and efficiency of other power plants on the system and the delivery of energy services in the whole. But the detractors would say, well, that's not what was intended by the initial statute, that they want to interpret a system as a technological system at a power plant. And this is the crux of the debate. Not being a lawyer, I'm not positioned to take a stand on that issue, but that's what differentiates the two, the dueling definitions. Note that 111B, which is also part of the sort of the architecture of the Clean Power Plan in general, it remains in effect. It 111B regulates new sources, the new source performance standard, and it remains in effect today, even though it's under court under challenges in the court. The courts have said, okay, we're gonna suspend the challenges to that. It remains in effect until the EPA chooses to act. It's presuming that EPA doesn't want to open up the lawsuit on that while they may be in the business of replacing that as well. So we have a situation where 111B regulating new sources remains in effect, 111D is not in effect, and the Clean Air Act is pretty clear, the lawyers explained to me, that once 111B is in place, the EPA is compelled to then take the next step, which would be to regulate existing sources. So we're in this real limbo right now where something has to give. And the presumption that is throughout the literature and throughout the detractors from the Clean Power Plan initially would be that an inside the fence line approach would be used. And so what that means, we use that inside the fence line sort of colloquially, meaning that a power plant is a stationary source from which the emissions come, and so reductions in emissions, that is improvements in the emission rate realized through improvement in the heat rate at the plant is how you would achieve emission reductions. The heat rate is, these terms are used almost interchangeably, and they are almost interchangeable. So you won't go very far wrong if you refer to heat rate or emission rate interchangeably, because one leads into the other. Heat rate has to do with how much heat input into the plant in order to get kilowatt hours of electricity out. And the more efficient the heat rate, the lower will be the emissions rate. Okay, so to show you sort of the puzzle that the EPA faces, if it goes back to a step back from what the Obama administration was doing to an inside the fence line approach, this is pictures taken from Lin et al., a publication, one of the publications we've done here, that looks at, from the 2008 population of plants, what their heat input was on the vertical axis and their heat rate across the horizontal axis. So the heat input is energy, there's fuel use at the plant, and then their observed heat rate. And there's quite the take-home message from this, with the line being sort of the generation-weighted central value, huge heterogeneity across plants. So the challenge facing the agency is, what kind of regulation would you impose if improvements had to be done specifically at a plant? And when you're facing this kind of a picture, what regulation is going to address this wide population of plants? So there's been quite a bit of literature looking at this, and there's an engineering approaches and then empirical approaches. And from the engineering side, to ask how much could be achieved at that previous, on that previous grant plant picture, the central case, this is my construction of a central case, but I'm confident in saying that it's roughly, the engineering literature suggests you could achieve a 4% reduction in emissions rate on average across all those plants, and that would be at roughly a $30 per ton carbon reduced. Some of the studies that provide background for this are the Sargent and Lundy study, probably the one that's most often cited. It was cited by the EPA, and it suggests measures at the different plants are from $10 to $60 per ton. Lin et al. Looked at improvements up to the 90th percentile within a group, and the groups being defined as boiler size, design, vintage, pollution control, and they see possibility if everybody was up to 90th percentile, best performance in each class of 6% improvement. And the Bipartisan Policy Center looked at best in class within the group, which is very, very close to what Kathy was describing in her inside the fence line approach, where investments were required of, they did two scenarios of 25% or 40% of the gap within a group of moving up to best in class. and that yields 4 to 6% emission reductions as a consequence. So let me just jump ahead and show you that one of the conundrums that emerge here is that using Lynn et al., these results from Lynn et al., even after sorting the whole population of plants into these groups that are defined by vintage and technology type, there still is a wide variety of heterogeneity within each of these groups. So that here we have the total all units broken into three boiler types, tangential, front, and opposed, and there's the heterogeneity survives. Okay, so that's what the engineering look at that, and economists are notoriously skeptical of engineering estimates, and so Lynn et al. Took a look at, from a statistical standpoint, what can you see in terms of the actual behavior of the operation of power plants over time? And the way this was done was to look at 25 years of observed heat rate performance as it responds to changes in fuel prices, taking changes in fuel prices historically as a proxy for the regulatory costs that would be imposed on power plants under the Clean Power Plan. And the opportunity from what is observed is less promising than the range of engineering forecasts, but the cost is very similar within the range that has been observed. So the observations within historical variation in coal prices and relative fuel prices relative to natural gas lead to just 0.1 to 0.4% improvements in heat rate that are statistically significant, respond to changes in fuel costs. In other words, when coal gets more expensive, plant operators make investments, the heat rate improves. And that those small range of improvements are realized at about $1.64 per ton. And it implies that, you know, extending somewhat further, that in a range of 0.6 to 2% of heat rate improvements, that could be achieved at about $10 per ton. But going further than that, as far as the engineering studies suggest is possible, is out of sample. It hasn't been observed from the way plants are actually operated because fuel prices haven't changed to the degree that's implied there. But I want to emphasize that these estimates here and the empirical estimates are holding utilization fixed. These are then run in a simulation model, holding utilization of all the plants fixed. But that's one of the conundrums that leads to the results that Kathy is showing you, is this so-called rebound effect. That when you improve the heat rate at a plant and make it more efficient, you reduce the variable cost of operating that plant. And there's a chance that you'll get a rebound, greater utilization of the plant because it's cheaper to operate. And consequently, some of the emission reductions you might have expected holding utilization fixed are eroded. You get more reductions. And also, these plants are located in different parts of the country in different geographic settings. You might get some plants that actually run and have greater emissions than they did in the reference case, and some that don't. So on average, there's going to be a distribution. And that can help explain why you get some of the negative signs in Kathy's health consequences maps when from the inside the fence line approach. It can actually lead in some cases to greater conventional air pollutants. The second is that these investments, because it leads the plants to be more economical, tends to lead them to delay retirement. So they have a longer lifetime. So cumulatively over into the next decade, you can get greater emissions of both CO2 and conventional air pollutants from heat rate improvements of the plants. So in performance standard simulations with Lynn et al., we found that rebound was 22 to 33% of the emission reductions were eroded from this rebound effect. And then the economists can't help but insert parenthetically here that under a tax, the rebound is about 1%. It's virtually zero, and for reasons that deserve a separate conversation. But the performance standard approach is what leads to a rebound effect. Okay. So the possible approaches and conundrums that the EPA faces. In the face of this heterogeneity across plants, the economic advice would be that for an efficient standard would require a component-by-component approach. The EPA has to have information about what has been installed at different plants in order to understand why the heterogeneity and there's distribution, because there are different, not only different vintages, but different equipment at the different plants. But that information is not available to the EPA. In order for the EPA to get that information, they would have to do an information request, which OMB is almost certain to oppose because it's frequently viewed as regulatory overreach and additional paperwork burden for the industrial sector. So EPA is then operating in the realm of very poor information, and it may have to fall back then on a one-size-fits-all approach. the one-size-fits-all approach can lead to greater retirements than were otherwise intended by the current administration, because you're imposing the same kind of costs on plants wherever they are in that distribution of their heat rates, even though the opportunities at the plants are quite different. So that's why economists prefer incentive-based approaches where plant owners have take advantage of flexibility and the private information they have, but a one-size-fits-all approach doesn't make that approach available. So the standard definition, the standard solution to this dilemma is flexibility, but that's a slippery slope for the EPA here because, well, any kind of flexibility suggests that even at a given plant, they might start doing co-firing with biomass or with natural gas because it might be cheaper than making any kind of mechanical changes at the plant. The use of natural gas for co-firing in order to reduce emissions rate is, first of all, a very inefficient use of natural gas, and the plant engineers hate you for it. But secondly, it's also a flat marginal cost curve there. I mean, you can do a little bit of natural gas and reduce the emissions rate, and then you do a little bit more and you reduce it further. So since it's a flat marginal cost curve there, where is the stopping rule for how much natural gas to use at an existing coal-fired boiler? The EPA might get around that by a fuel-specific standard. So they might subcategorize and say, okay, we're going to use an inside-the-fence-line approach and have a different standard for different boiler types and say that it can only be for use of coal. You don't get any credit for co-firing. Now, the EPA's new view is that the electricity sector is not a system. So it would be inconsistent to allow trading or averaging across facilities. So all that you could do there is have plant-specific standards, and we still see a lot of heterogeneity in costs and opportunities at that level. So EPA might have thought to designate to a state the authority in development of state implementation plans, because the states are required to develop a state plan, and delegate to the state the authority to possibly reintroduce flexibility. But then there's two conundrums that follow. One is, well, a state or two neighboring states might say, well, flexibility means we could reach across state borders and do an interstate trading system, or maybe it means they could re-entertain the idea of mixing fuel types. And second is that there would be a federal implementation plan, state implementation plan inconsistency, that the EPA at the federal level would have said this kind of flexibility is not authorized, but they can not very well then approve state plans to do the exact same thing. So finally, EPA may impose trivial requirements, which is probably the most likely pathway going forward. But then the question is a little emission reduction sufficient for the trouble that the agency will go through to develop this rule, and in the eyes of the judges, when they look at the obligation under the Clean Air Act to mitigate harm as identified under the endangerment finding, will very trivial investments at a small number of plants be sufficient? So that's where I think we stand right now. There is the trade press has suggested there's an advance notice of proposed rulemaking, and it looks like at the OMB website that there is a proposed rulemaking at OMB, so we may know about it within a matter of weeks what the replacement rule might take. So that's the end of my comments, and now I'm going to invite Alan and Kathy to come up, and we're going to take some questions from you and from Twitter. So I hope you have those questions ready. Thank you.
First is, which I think Dallas already started touching on, how is it that an inside the fence line approach actually has disbenefits? Unpack that for us a bit. Is this about coal plants running more intensively due to the rate nature of the standard, substituting for gas or renewables? Tell us a little bit about that. And then the second question is, how is it that the incremental benefits below the 12 micrograms threshold actually lead to incrementally bigger than above the threshold? That seems inconsistent with this slope of the shape of the function that Alan laid out. So maybe that function that Alan laid out, which was a nonlinear function, is not correct. Maybe unpack that for us a bit.
Sure. So thank you for the questions. On the issue of disbenefits, I think Dallas explained that fairly well. It varies a bit region by region, and we dug into the generation numbers where we saw a disbenefit to look at what actually happened in the model that caused that increase in emissions. So in the case of California, it turns out that there is additional co-firing with biomass that leads to an increase in SO2 emissions above the reference case. In all of the other regions, it turns out that the increased efficiency of the coal plant itself moves that up in the dispatch order, longer run times and greater emissions from those plants than otherwise would occur under a clean power plan, where you would tend to see that decrease. On the question of the shape of the curve and the steepening of the slope below the NACs, the literature has long expected that relationship to be monotonic, linear, or log linear. And that is still the case in this new study, but with a sort of a spline method, they were able to look for whether there was a break in that linear relationship below the NACs. What exactly, I have on several phone calls to sort of understand the mechanism that you would look to for explaining that. And I didn't actually get to speak to the authors, but so there's it could be related to the fact that once there's been an exposure at higher concentrations, there's an increased susceptibility so at the full range of the exposure. And so that even at that lower ambient level, the susceptible person has a greater response at diminishing levels of exposure. So really, that's probably a question for the people who authored that study, including Joel Schwartz as the sort of overarching investigator behind that work. But it's an interesting question. It's a very large, has high statistical power with the 61 million people. And I think it's very important for addressing some of the uncertainties that people have pointed to.
Just one comment in addition to that. This is quite a break with standard research so far, but this is a huge database with a lot of power. Although the original Pope et al. And then the Kruski study that was up on my slide there were very large studies as well, although not of this size, and didn't find that. But think about the profound effect, if this were true, that the function, so again, instead of a threshold or instead of going like this to the origin, if the origin's over here, this function would go like this. So where do you set the standard? The tighter the standard is, the greater the additional health benefit. So it really creates, like, what do you do then? We don't allow pollution at all. I mean, it's difficult.
So it goes down to five.
Goes
I should
to five.
Say it looks to NACs to five.
Okay, so you go to five.
And there is a shape. There is a new curve in this paper.
So now you're at 12. You would go to five.
I just want to add on to what Kathy's response about the effects, for example, in California, that there is change in utilization of plants in the periphery of California, not within California. And then there's also change in the use of natural gas as a consequence within California. So that is leading to change in NOx emissions also. So these are in the realm of small changes at the system perturbation, and then you see these kind of changes occurring in unexpected ways throughout the country. Yes, thanks.
Hi, thank you for holding this. Teresa Pugh with Teresa Pugh Consulting. I have one, just a clarification. When all of you say within fence line, do you mean a unit? Not where there's multiple units within a fence line? You always mean a unit?
No, I think these are plants. These are considered plants.
Right. A plant is a unit, correct?
If you've got three plants,
mm-hmm. If you've got three generating stations, uh-huh. Within a fence line, did you count it three different times, or did you combine it as one? Is it a unit? That's what I'm asking.
Wait, in our analysis, it was a unit retrofit.
Great, okay.
It was a unit by unit, not at the plant level. Mm-hmm. Okay,
it's unit by unit.
Thank you, good for you, thanks.
Okay, so the question is, how did any of you all look at heat rate with ramping, given that there's so much more intermittent renewables, and whether that's on gas plants or whether it's affected some of the heat rate questions. Did this ever come up, and how did you handle it?
That hasn't come up in this work, and that's a fair point, that the introduction of renewables may lead to more ramping. More ramping will erode the heat rate of facilities and lead to greater emissions per megawatt hour coming out of those facilities. Yeah.
Yes, my name is Rich Blasian, environmental science journalist. Thanks for this excellent presentation. So I have a question, very simple, about going back to the California example. In this interim, this period of limbo, what's going on? Are there utilities sort of going back to their old facilities, ramping them up, or looking at them, or are there some utilities having sort of we're still in it mentality? What's on the ground, and how long is this interim period?
I think there's a lot of confusion and waiting to see for the other shoe to drop here. You know, on the one hand, you see, I think, 17 announcements since January of 2016 of coal plant retirements. So even in the wave of expected relief for the industry, if there was regulation that was causing these effects, it's evident that it's market forces that are the primary force that's leading to changes in the generation mix, and that will continue to be the most important force going forward. That is, in particular, the price of natural gas and its influence on the economic viability of coal plants. But there are some areas where you have seen increased investments in coal plants. So I think it, and that is in terms of retrofits and modernization. I've only seen a couple articles as suggesting some of that is occurring, and I don't really know anywhere specifically where it's occurring.
There may also be an effect of states picking up the slack. So in states where there are still strong commitments, you may see some utilities planning with that in mind. We certainly saw some of that in the case of the mercury and air toxic standards. When that rule was in limbo, a lot of the states stepped forward with their own standards, and that led plants to begin to address mercury emissions, and in some retired rather than take on that cost. So we might look to pass policy to as prelude here.
The economist Larry Summers has said that the greatest cost of climate change so far has been the uncertainty associated with climate with mitigation policy and the effect it has had on investments. And I think that if you look at like the interveners with respect to the repeal of the Clean Power Plan, there are a lot of companies on both sides of that. There weren't just the petitioners asking for repeal of the Clean Power Plan. There were some coal-dominated companies that were arguing to keep the Clean Power Plan in place because they had already begun serious compliance activities, and they just wanted to lock into that future. So we continue to operate in an environment of tremendous uncertainty in the industry.
Thank you.
This is going to have to be our last question because we're hitting the end of the hour, and we want to make sure people can expect to get out of here on time. So thank you.
Michael Leifman, independent consultant. So I remember reading a study years ago, probably written by one of you or maybe by Dick, that one of the regs under the Clean Air Act, the aspirin rule, had the greatest benefits of any rule, not just in environmental regulatory landscape, but period. And so the idea of either discounting or minimizing ancillary benefits from this rule actually strikes me as pretty worrisome and generally is in line philosophically with some of the things that the current administration has espoused. I'm wondering if you've looked at what else is at risk and in danger, right? Are there other major regs where benefits rely heavily on ancillary benefits?
Well, yeah, almost. I mean, a lot of different regs. The fuel economy standards would have them in there. The famous one, I couldn't hear the actual rule you referred to. Did you refer to mercury?
The acid rain trading rule.
The which?
Acid rain.
Oh, acid rain, yeah. So the mercury rule is infamous or famous in that regard, too, for having the ancillary benefits dominate the mercury benefit. So I think any rule that's going to affect the way fuel is used anywhere is going to have, but it's not directly targeting the reducing these precursors of PM2.5. And those more than ozone, where the mortality ozone relationship is flatter than the PM2.5 mortality relationship, you're gonna hit this. I don't think this will stand, though. Honestly, I don't.
Well, and in fact, not being a lawyer and not knowing the Clean Air Act by heart, but I do know this part of the Clean Air Act by heart, and the phrase other environmental outcomes is specifically mentioned in Section 111. So it would seem that the Congress intended for there to be consideration of other environmental outcomes, but there would be, in one incarnation of this, explicitly omitted from the RIA. That seems inconsistent with the original legislative intent.
And by the way, the other thing that we can learn from acid rain, I think, is that it's a perfect case of where the benefits were much higher and the costs were much, much lower than were anticipated in that rule. And so interesting that we now see assessments that have, you know, just the reverse in the expectation, when really I think that is a very instructive case for how things actually play out once there's a standard in place.
Okay, that's going to be it for today. Thank you very much for being here.
Thank you. Thanks for the questions.